one bite was good, but man, I need another. Man, that's good. How could it not happen? It couldn't have not happened. This was our first time on the earth, first time feeling physical pleasures of the flesh and also the senses, being able to do different things in nature, co-creating the world. Of course we had to fall. It was only natural. We were human beings, for crying out loud. It's kind of like how a kid comes into a kitchen and the parent says, hey, don't touch that stove, it's hot. What's hot? All she said was, it's hot. We don't know what it is. You have to touch it in order to feel it. The fall. We had to overindulge in something in order to know what not indulging it was. In order to find balance, you first have to go to one extreme, then find your extreme, your sense of balance later on. Your center point. So there's nothing forbidden about this fruit. And it's not by coincidence that when people are in their peak moments, they say what? Oh my. It's very, very connected. So what happened? Well, picture the spirit of, I use terms that we can understand, but it's just a term. If you use the spirit up here, that creates a double of itself in our own image. We make man and female in our own image. And you bring them down to earth, or you help them be there, you help them be on earth, and you send them to explore the five senses of the flesh. Well, if this little person down here is experiencing the five senses of the flesh to the point where they start forgetting about this person, what do you get? Pinocchio. You start cutting off your strings with the puppeteer, exploring your own world. Exploring your own free will. Eventually cutting yourself off from spirit temporarily. Spirit's always there giving directions. But a long time ago, we were much more connected than how we are today. So what happened was that the puppet down here became like a fallen angel. So we all have our own personal Satan to deal with. Our own devil, our own dark side, our own shadow. There's only one thing that doesn't cast a shadow, and that's light. So if you become overly pure in this lifetime, there's no reason for you to be on earth. You'll probably die in some way. Which is why our elders a long time ago, they said, don't try to be too good. Keep a little bit of sin. It keeps you here in this realm, they said, longer. Keeps you in balance. Because every demolition crew needs its demolition man. In order to rebuild something new, you have to destroy the old first. So that 1% darkness always has its good points, but control it. Because if you don't control it, that's when it becomes a beast. And it ravages you instead of helping you. So the human body is built much the same way as a tree. We even have sayings like, well, that was a sappy show, or else, I'm at the university, but I'm branching out in a new field. Or, get to know your roots. There's a reason why we have sayings connected to trees is because our body is like a tree. We have a trunk. We have roots that connect us with the ground. And limbs, members. And within that tree of ours, there's also a snake, a serpent, a serpentine energy. Not literally a snake, but a snake-like energy. When we're operating at full spiritual capacities, that snake that now is referred to as the Kundalini lives all the way to the top and beyond this tree, all the way down to the bottom. Lives in both at once. Acts like a messenger, like email, back and forth all the time. But the thing is that a long time ago, once we started overindulging in the earth, we started forgetting our identities. Our spiritual identities have become more and more physical, like ice. What did the snake do? Well, said something, well, I'm going to help those people down there. So we started slithering down that tree until finally. It's kind of like we went from a high energy And then because of our overindulgence at certain activities here on Earth, we started going down to a low energy. Shut down. What was once a fully rechargeable, non-disposable battery all of a sudden became a throwaway item. When our batteries grow older, our hair gets grayer. It's a natural process. Our face starts getting a little bit changed, or too. We start losing the elasticity of the flesh. The light within us wants to go back to its source. We die. So what happened? When we died, ashes went to ashes, dust went to dust, but the light went back to the light. And when we got back into the light, it was... I'll tell you something. I want to burn in fire forever, because I know now that I am fire. And when I become re-immersed in fire, my own true self, light, electricity, energy, will become re-immersed in something much greater than what it was, like a drop of water to the ocean. That's been separated from the ocean for billions of years. That water droplet feels ecstasy when it goes back into its original source. That's how we're going to feel when we get back in there. So Spirit looked at us and said, how could you allow yourselves to forget who you were? You were supposed to experience the five senses of the flesh for us and relay back and forth what it was like to live on Earth. You were supposed to experience them for us. So they showed us our lives on the big screen, like a life review. And we were our own judges. So this was our judgment day, because there's nobody that's a worse critic than ourselves. We know that. Nobody's harder or dumps more shit on us than ourselves. So we thought, yeah, that's true. We didn't do enough of that there. We did too much of that there. Is there a second chance? And whatever higher energy said, yeah, of course there is. You can fix the wrongs. Okay, well, we'll go back. We said, we'll go back. But if we went back the same way we went up, it would have been too easy to remember who we were. So we had to devise an additional challenge for us, one that would force us, often through pain and suffering, in remembering who we were as spiritual beings. What was that challenge? It's when you take something that is whole and you divide it into two separate identities, personalities. One has what the other one doesn't. Yin, yang, A, B, 1, 2. So one of those beings had muscular strength. One of the beings had spiritual and emotional strength. And the little game that we've been playing with each other ever since has kind of been going on like this. I was wondering where that one went. Thanks. See, a long time ago, originally, every person was more like this, both a king and a queen at the same time, male and female. Kind of like the color purple. You know that the color purple is made of red and blue. But you can't really see blue, and you can't really see red. You see a combination of both. But it can go either way. It can become more like blue, it become more like red. So our original physical gender at that time was more fluid. We could appear more like women, we could appear more like men, according to how the desire went. So when we came back down to here, when we reincarnated, we sent ourselves back as single people. Same thing with these. This, and this is the little game that we've been playing with each other ever since. This guy is, he's skateboarding. No, he's mountain biking. He's mountain biking on a trail, and this woman's walking her dog, except that he's coming around a bend in the corner, doesn't see her. Crash! Why don't you watch where you're going, you dumb jerk? You almost killed me and my dog! I'm sorry, ma'am. I'm really sorry. Look, it was a total accident. Can I make it up to you? Can I ask you out for dinner? What? Yeah. Okay. They become a couple. This woman here... No, let's make it interesting. These two are already a couple. This guy gets jealous of this guy. He says, I want to date her instead. So what does he do? He goes to the hotel, rents a room, 312, room 312. And he says, hey, here's my hotel room key. You can come and visit me in the middle of the night. I know you want me. So what does she do? In the middle of the night, she goes over to the hotel room and, you know, this guy finds out. Oh, he's not going to take that with no smile. He goes back to his house and he gets a gun. He goes back to the hotel room and sends them both back into the light. Pew. Of course, this guy eventually gets found out, goes to jail. This is where it gets pretty interesting. This guy is in a bar. It's a different kind of bar. Not an ordinary kind of bar. This guy walks into that same bar. They see each other and at first sight. These two ladies, the same thing. They see each other and they find so much in common that eventually they fuse together. Ironically enough, this lady says, no, not for me. I'm going to stay by myself. So she stays by herself. This guy gets reincarnated, comes back, and becomes fused with this woman. And then, you know, I could go on and on. It's the great soulmate shuffle. What is the perfect human being? The perfect human being contains all of the traits found within every other person at some point in time. We contain all their best qualities and all their possible potential negative traits as well. We become at one with immensity. But we all come from the same deck of cards. So whatever hand that we're dealt with in life, whoever you choose to bind with, that's your business. Nobody has the friggin' right to decide who you are going to fuse with. Whether it's these two, I never know how this is going to work out, or these two. If you want to live like this, that's fine too. We're already spiritually married with one another, and we've been trying each other out for billions of years. I'm not going to say how many girlfriends I've had over the years, but if I had to choose between all of them to say which one I'd like to live with the most, I'd have a hard time because I love them all equally for different reasons, even to this day, despite some of the good breakups and the bad breakups. But I can still see the good within each relationship experience. Regardless of who you choose to be with, as long as first connection is sincere, then what happens down here, it's as long as it doesn't involve children and animals. Okay. Mature mindsets. Whoa, boy. Oh, this is where the fun starts. Here we have spiritual beings that have suffered a form of amnesia. And they're physical beings now. They're no longer like vapor or water. They're more like ice. Physical. Now they have to thrive and survive in this hostile world. Something very unfortunate happened here. We started feeling hunger pangs. And we started looking at the other beings around us that we co-created with hunger in our eyes. Because fruit and nuts weren't going to cut it any longer. We needed calories. Heavy-duty calories. So we started looking at them with hunger. We thought, shouldn't matter. We help that one to be anyway. Shouldn't matter if it falls to the ground and gives us something to eat. So we started stalking them. And eventually what happened was that one action of killing another being These are just representations. It might have happened on a microbial scale as well, with germs. When we started killing another being for food, it detonated a worldwide chain reaction of events, leading other animals to become carnivores, and some not, and even some plants to become carnivores. Today, we're quite possibly the only species that can tame absolutely any animal out there. We've tamed tarantulas, anacondas, boa constrictors, grizzly bears, and right now in Australia, people are actually paying money to go on charter tours on boats when people chum the area around the boats and they bring great white sharks, sharks that are 17, 18, 19, 23 feet in length. They come up to the boat and people can actually take the nose of the sharks, rub the sharks, these huge amounts of sharks that have teeth this big, and they rub the sharks and the shark stays there, letting itself get petted. And they push the shark gently back into the water and the shark just goes back in a daze. National Geographic had a special on that. We can tame and we can teach absolutely every animal on the face of the earth to once again become harmless. But the change first begins with us. They're waiting for us to make the first move with one another. They're still violent with each other and with us because they see us having wars with each other. Once they see us, once they see us in a different mindset, they'll do the same thing for themselves. They'll re-evolve. So the opposite can happen. Just like how our violence with one another and with them detonate a reaction, the opposite can happen with them as well, leading them to become docile and gentle. In Eden, this original Eden that we call Earth, there was no need for the shedding of blood for life to feed itself. Violence wasn't there. It's an anomaly, and it continues to exist today. So the male energy, well, what he had was power of the muscles. The female part of that original energy, she retained her powers of bearing life and also of nurturing strength, emotional strength. So began the long climb of civilization. It took us thousands and thousands of years to learn how to apply in technological terms the original abilities that we had back then. We knew that back then we could communicate instantly worldwide with one another, just through thought alone. And then it progressed to messengers. Run 150 miles this way, you'll find another camp, send them a message. And then it progressed to what? Telegrams. Smoke signals, before that, I guess. Telephones. Internet. What's next? Teleportation? People in Austria, physicists in Austria, have already demonstrated that that's a possibility. We're on a journey together, and we're going to re-evolve to how we were. It's going to take some time. So we started forming little tribes, little families, and started getting into the creation of buildings, vehicles, fires. Stone Age technologies at first, of course, then metal, and now we're dealing with fiber optics and lasers. Incredible. My great-grandmother saw the last of the buffalo cross between Candu and Red Pheasant, Saskatchewan. For 3 days, she couldn't travel to the North Battleford because the buffalo were passing through. She had to watch the herd. Every day she would go back and she would see the, because if you go in amongst a herd of buffalo, you're going to become a buffalo patty yourself. You know, good chance the bulls are going to challenge you. So she had to wait. So it's amazing the kind of changes our forefathers and foremothers have seen. And I can tell you right now, just like how many people were talking, Nick comes to mind, Ian, we're going to see tremendous changes from here on. We're going to evolve at an exponential rate in our evolution. And then, after a while, we started getting into technologies with capabilities way more advanced than even our best technologies today. We're getting there. We're getting there. But back then, the technology that existed, mind-blowing. And not because they were complicated, but because they were so simple. You see, when something becomes so complicated, something strange happens. It doesn't become more and more complex. It becomes simpler and simpler. Like a fisherman. When you're 15, 16 years old, you start off, well, I started off with, my grandfather used to cut me a willow off the banks, and I used to have a real hook, not a bobby pin. But that was my fishing gear. And then when I got a little bit of money, when I got my first job, I said, no way, man, I want a fly fishing rod, because that looked cool. you know. And then, of course, I had to have the waders, the vest, the Orvis fly fishing glasses, the hat, the decals. And now that I know a little bit more about the animals, I don't even have a fishing rod anymore. When I fish, it's with a line tied to the end of the canoe. And I catch more fish, because I don't have to cast anymore, I just paddle. Our technology is much the same. Our technology will evolve to the point where it actually becomes simple again, and eventually even organic, as we can see now between the merger of organics and silicon fiber optic material. The computer world and organic world will one day merge as one. We're hearing it from all over. Different authors are talking about that. Life was pretty easy for the people back then who evolved to that point, but we still had growth with one another. So what happened? Well, if power can be a dangerous thing, then absolute power can. So the people that were living in the top echelons of these societies, what we call CEOs, executives, presidents, commanders, chiefs, they started getting a little jealous of one another. That guy's got a bigger car. I want a big house too. I want more people to control under my nation so that I can initiate wars with my colleague so that we can generate more income for each other to beat our adversaries. War creates money. Lots of money. Lots and lots and lots of money. So they started dealing and relating with each other in a very different way than how we originally did. Of course, you can't have chaos for too long until order decides to set itself back in. So what happened? Eventually, warring and disharmony with each other started to be so great and infecting all the realms of the earth that the earth herself, because she is a living being, she decided one day to shake, rattle, and roll. Slowly at first, and it happened over several hundred years, but it did happen. With each bout being successively greater than the last. Not many people knew how to live like this. Very few people know how to live like this anymore when they were in that state. So the survivors of these calamities, it was easier for them just to die off. It was too traumatic upon the soul to even think about living on in a world where all of the fancy conveniences were gone. Think about what a worldwide crash of the internet would do right now. Think of how many dot-com companies have started up. Think of how people are addicted to the internet and email. You'd have psychiatrists and psychologists' offices filled to the max for about another 20 years. Serious. And you'd have suicides. You'd have people jumping off bridges. You'd have rioting in the streets. You have people blaming it on government conspiracy, all sorts of things. So when these things started happening, when natural calamities happened on the earth, it did it in such a way that because the earth is a living being, she sort of said to herself, well, I'm not going to let my children remember who they are just yet. I want them to learn through a little bit of pain and suffering who they are, because they did not act like the way I told them to in the beginning. So all of our great monuments, they fell. Lava coated them. They decompose in a manner that they were unrecognizable thousands and thousands of years later. When we go down into the islands of Bimini in search of Atlantis or the Rhodes, we see fractions, tiny little fractions of what might have existed back then. Atlantis, Lemuria, these civilizations that had technology so advanced that they were actually simple. Now there's a reason why these three cars have black bars on the top and on the bottom. It's a television rerun. This rise and fall of civilizations has been happening over and over and over again until we finally get the point that we're interconnected as one. That even the best original idea still comes from a borrowed mind. We're connected with each other on our wavelengths, on our emotional lengths. We're lovers in a spiritual sense. And when we start relating to one another in this way, there's consequences. There's dire consequences that happen. So where are we today? Today appears that we're living mostly like this. Some people in the world are still living like this. Very few are still living like that, except by choice, maybe. Not too many remote tribes of indigenous people anymore. You can go up to Old Crow in the Yukon and have full internet access, DVD players, and drugs. Everything's accessible nowadays. So, what's happening? We're like that. This is already going on in some parts of the world. It's been happening for some time now. In some parts of the world, and even here, not so much here, but more like down in the States, and well, we have our own stuff to deal with here, like drought and stuff like that. This stuff is already starting to happen with increasing frequency. Will our kind suffer the same kind of fate as this? And will we have to go back through thousands of years of remembering again, slowly and painfully? Or maybe a miracle can happen. There's a miracle that happens whenever every soul, every person, every entity, on their own will, and not with anybody dictating to them of how they should do it or when. When you decide to unite with something that is greater than yourself, your own higher self, you can exist within that circle of life and live in both realms at once and help reestablish harmony here on Earth. And that's some of the change that we can see happen in the future. It just depends on our own will. What do we want to do? It's up to us. This is the end of part one, which is the longest part of the story. Parts two and three are much shorter. And I think I'll just jump right into them because I think we only have about an hour left. So hopefully, I hope you enjoyed this part. If you want to take a short break, I'll just lean up the cards right here, right away, and I'll start part two when we get back.
Enjoy the show. Thank you. Welcome, Stefan. How was it? Big welcome.
Thank you. Is everybody that is here tonight, were they also here last night to hear part one?
No.
Okay, so some people weren't. I'll do a very quick review of the cards that were presented last night, so it'll put you up to date, because otherwise part two just won't make any sense at all. Okay? I'll run through them quite quickly, but it'll give you a good gist of what we talked about last night. Ooh. I don't want to get too close there. The first card demonstrates that there's a circle, and like the circle, we're eternal. There's no end to us. And then before we came to be in a physical body, in our memory, there's a memory of a light. And that light is made up of seven parts in terms of physics, and we could call them heavens, making up the heaven. So there's seven heavens. And these heavens live within our bodies in the form of chakras. So much of all this is what our people already know. I'm just presenting it in a storytelling format. And in that light, we were living there as light spirits, and we continue living there. Well, actually, we're in it right now. We're just in a different dimension of it. And we're able to shape-shift, be at one with others' thoughts on a conscious level, and with their emotions as well. So we're interconnected as one. So there's no possible feeling other than just a love that blows us away. Like, it's awesome to get back in there because it's a homecoming. Once the Big Bang happened, we took a part in that. We helped create that because there's no end to our existence. What the astronomers, when they speak of the Big Bang, we actually played a part in what they're describing. We don't have a separate role with the past or the future. We're integrated into both. In the circle, there's also three elements that come together as one. They work like electricity, this interpretation anyway. That one is like the positive wire, one is the negative wire. When they come together, they form a little child between them that needs to be grounded, the grounding wire. And so you could have like the male, female, the yin-yang, creating the unification of the both like a child energy. Like the C3. That C and that 3 is gone by different names. Well, in Christianity we call it Christ. In my culture we call it the spirit that lives in all things, like a child energy. And in the movie Star Wars, we call it the Force. So it's like a sacred spider web and energy grid system that links everyone and everything together. It links your toe with the corner of that post, with the corner of that post, to that hat hanging over there, to that light bulb, to the sky that's shining. Everything is interconnected with that web. And once you connect yourself with it, you can feel by intuition alone what's going on in other places of the universe, and even different time spans. When we started gathering together, we started forming little families, and some of these families look different than how the one we have today with one sun. Our original solar system, and you'll find this in some literature in other places, Linda Goodman talks about it in her books. Also Gordon, Michael Scallion, has anybody ever heard of him? I think he mentions it in some point too. He mentions how at one time our solar system here was once two suns instead of one. And the Earth and the other planets, being in between both of those suns, or around them, didn't have a reason to revolve or rotate around either one of the suns. So she was more like free-floating, and more like a ball of gas than actual solid form. But as spirits, we started wondering. We started wondering about what it would be like to live in a physical body, or a semi-physical body, and have access to the five senses of the flesh. How did we get curious? Well, it's kind of like, hey, you have a cupboard, and you have a cupboard full of ingredients, but you don't know what the recipe is. We were curious. We wanted to experiment. We wanted to expand upon our powers of co-creation, because we have those powers of co-creation. We may not be the creator individually, but we certainly are co-creators, like drops of water to an ocean, like grains of sand to a beach. We make up what is called God, us and all the creation around us. We're tied to it. There's no separation from us and God. It's all illusional. So once we started getting curious, we thought, well, we'll have to make this Earth a physical place to live. So we extinguished or exploded one of those suns. We killed it off. And what happened was that the Earth was now sent to a wobbly spin around the remaining star. And what that did was that this created the birth of north and south directions, east, west, and also the four seasons, springtime, summertime, wintertime, fall time in different parts of the globe, and also, of course, the four elements, earth, water, air, and fire. The four elements were born, because of gravitational energy that was happening upon the Earth. The more the Earth spins together because of gravitational energy, the elements start fusing together and start taking on a more solid form. It stops being a big ball of gas and a little bit more dense. So then we stepped into the Earth, but before stepping into it, we made sure that this Earth was a beautiful place to be. So co-creating the Earth's creatures was an evolutionary process, but it was still creation. They're one and the same thing. When an idea, like this artwork for instance, it took 7 years for the ideas in this skull and this brain for it to finally come out on paper. But it still is created, and the idea had to evolve. So evolution and creation are just the same thing. It's just a different snapshot in time, depending on what our perspective is. Some of the original foods that we had to live as spirits living in a physical body here on Earth were foods that resembled, in a way, today's fruit and nuts. For the reason being is that when you pick a fruit or nut off a tree, it continues living. The tree doesn't die, it's not harmed in any way, because the fruit or the nut continues falling. The other reason for those is because there's an erotic appeal to fruit and nuts, for one, by their shape, and also their terminology. You can find the terminology in today's songs, pop songs especially. And for some reason, they were sung mostly in the 70s and the 60s. Free love, eh? And so as free spirits, we retained all of our abilities as shapeshifters, because in the light, when you don't have a physical body to hinder you, you can appear in any shape and form you want. I mean, there's no limits to how you want to appear. Well, when we first stepped onto the Earth and we were still operating 100% brain capacity, we didn't really need a body, but it was nice to have one once in a while whenever we wanted to step into this realm as caretakers of the Earth. So we could appear in any shape and form we want. Which one's better? Is it better to see a UFO or be a UFO? If you want to star travel, then all you had to do back then was just simply invite... I don't even know what to label it. In our culture, we say Gichi Manitou, great mystery, because we don't know what the heck to call it. But something that created us, and we just invited it in, and it took us to different realms whenever we wanted it, because our will was its will, and its will was our will at the same time. But it wasn't a master and a follower leading roles. It was equal leadership on both sides. I guess so. Like how they, when they say telepathy, like some people think of as telepathy, I have a thought and I'll send it over there really fast. Well, to some people, telepathy is like the idea springs at the same time instead of traveling to someplace. Mm-hmm. You know, so maybe it was something like that. The third step in becoming physical was that we took the four elements of earth, air, water, and fire, and we imploded them together, started mixing them in certain combinations. Very small at first, and over time, again, over much time, we started forming a body through which we could step into and feel those five senses of the flesh. And because we are light beings, essentially, you know, like how all the indigenous cultures have been telling us over the years, and our scientists are now finally starting to realize through quantum physics that we're made up of photons and stuff. When we came into our bodies, we put the light into our bodies. But the light also lives outside of us. There's no separation between us and the outside world. That's why, like, whenever we have a mood, and if groups of people have a certain mood, it'll affect the weather. You know? You're feeling blue? Whoa. Watch out for blue skies pretty soon. Or rainy skies, you know? If you're feeling bright and sunny,